Good evening, folks. All right, let's pause this music. Good evening, good evening. We want to welcome our viewers and listeners across the globe. I'm Afonso Zansor, right here this evening, as usual, sitting in for the liberal progressive who is on AWOL, and he asked me to be here. Esther Thomas, good to have you here. Yvette Green, Joyce, the legendary Sister Goyo. The phone calls I've been receiving since the last stop is just crazy. Francis Trouble, good to have you here. Mad Hop, hopefully I'm calling it. Admin, thank you so much. And our own Benjamin Tewer is LPR Bureau Chief in the neighborhood of La Côte d'Ivoire. Abidjan is joining us this early late evening hours in the West African state of the Republic of Côte d'Ivoire. Ben, thank you so much for your extraordinary job that you're doing to Prosper Divine Prophetic Ministry. Wow. Prosper Divine Prophetic Ministry. Good to have you here. I think we're going to have it's a blessing to have the prophetic ministry. Allison Mami, thank you so much. Alvin Favored Freeman, we want to welcome all of you this evening. As usual, this is the Diaspora Informative News outlet like Republic Radio and LPR TV. We are here literally Monday to Fridays and Sunday to discuss community issue, news making headlines together, all of us, whether you agree or disagree with us. We are in the business of having these critical conversations for the good of the country. Louise Moore, thank you so much. Always here. We really, really appreciate Pauline, Jay Command, Rita Harris, Quita, thank you so much. Hopefully I'm doing good calling these names, because if it was a liberal, trust me, he would never do that. He will only love for those who cheer him up, who celebrate him. Well, we want to welcome our viewers and listeners across the globe. This is the Diaspora Informative News Outlet, Liberal Public Radio. I am Afonso Zienso, filling in here for the Liberal Progressive. Welcome to the show. Good evening, good evening. So we want to welcome all our viewers and listeners across the globe. I'm Afonso Zienso, right here from the Diaspora Informative News Outlet, New England Bureau, if you will, to say it or give you more details who we are and what we represent. We say good to have you here this evening, this morning, depending on your location. Thank you so much for always taking time out to listen to some of the tabata and some of the things that we talk about here. But I do know there's a greater tie pack of information we share with you, and you also share with us, for we value your time, your energy, and your commitment to this network. Without you, we can't do it. There's no way that I come here, either the laborers and all of the analysts, to talk, by themselves. We have to create that connections of communication. And trust me, your interactions, the level of civility that is maintained on this network, that's what is key. That's what Liberia requires. We must listen to all sides of the story. So no matter whether we agree with them or disagree with them, we must accommodate. And this is why this network, we intend not to leave no one behind in the national conversations of Liberia, because we are in a consequential time and we know how polarized the society is. So all must be accommodated regardless of our own political attachment and association. Every little one protect his or her own alligator in the sense that they put out a good defense line, argument, with respect to what is going on. But the greater thing of all is the mutual respect that we always uphold right here on this network. We do appreciate that. Please always roll in your suggestions as to how we can improve our conversations for the good of the country. And you can possibly make suggestions on some of the things that we need to talk and that we should be talking. We are talking about a country, so everything must be inclusive. But the politics aspect is that takes control of our life. These are the people, their decision, their policy making, their actions, their administrative decisions is what controls our life. So it appears to take dominant role into what we talk about for which. But as time goes by, we understand we've been visiting all sectors of society, which is very key, which is very much vital for the good of the country. I am your host,
right here from the New England Beirut of the Liberal Public Radio, Afonso Zienso, sitting in for the Liberal Progressive, and he always have the guts to tell his follower why I'm here to cheer him up. He is another version of Donald Trump who loves to be cheered. People like him, people admire him. And I have my guy here, Rogers, who seems to be getting this sort of gun-smoking type cheering squad ongoing here to get the Liberal to do what he's doing. Help us, God. He, the life of Terry, Sisi, they are trying to find the real political identity of these people in terms of whether they are from the red or blue, but the Liberal is doing everything possibly he can to liberalize this network. That's not going to happen. We'll make a fair balance right here. Let's take a quick commercial break, and I will be right back at the analyst assembling backstage, and we're going to be breaking them. But let's go to those people who happen to keep the wheel of this industry spinning. To all our viewers and listeners, thank you. Do us a favor. Hit the share button. Invite someone at the company. Subscribe to LPR. We'll make the news fair, balanced, and proportionate. Let's get it all rolling. Let's take a quick commercial break, and I will be right back.
Hello, welcome to Okumusa Grocery, 6523 Woolen Avenue in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
I'm a customer of Okumusa. I came here to get some things from grocery. Their things are so nice. They never get expired. They are the best quality. They have the best price ever anyone can get. They have so many things like cream, like meat, a lot of kind of meat. We have so many kinds, and it's the best grocery store I've ever seen here in Wood. We are located at the 65th and Woodland. If you want, I really appreciate you guys to come over to come and patronize with us, because they sell the best quality.
Uncle Musa's Groceries on Woodland Avenue, 6523. Woodland Avenue, Philadelphia, PA. Musa's store is composed of varieties of African food, as well as Americans, but predominantly African food. You have dry fish, you have cassava, you have yams, you have plantains, bananas, and Musa even goes out of his way to pay people extra to cut the potato grains for customers to save them extra time. We have we have fufu, we have the refrigeration center, then we also have cosmetics. This is a place to come in Philadelphia. If you come to Philly, you don't reach to Uncle Musa's Groceries, you have not made your trip complete. Welcome, and we look forward to seeing you sponsoring our business. Thank you.
This is Uncle Musa's store. 6523 Woodland Avenue. It's the only store, a grocery store, that deals with African stuff. Anything African thing, you can get from Uncle Musa's store. I am from Igbo, in Nigeria. So, in the Igbo dum,
Uncle Musa store. Uncle Musa is one of our sponsors. Let's welcome our prime time viewer, Fatima. Good to have you here. And I know we're from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Is that Diego? I love those terms. So, Roof Car, thank you for being here. Teddy Lion Tenyakot is one of the weirdest. You guys are getting prepared for 2029. Man, you've got a long time to wait, Jesus. But they are still keeping hope alive. Thomas Dysart, William Jackson, Tina Mack, James, good to be here to all of you. Today is a special day for someone in my life, and I think I must be gracious. You know, there are certain people you have them by your side, nothing is easy to hook you because she's so special. And let me just do this one here. Mm-hmm.
For then I have been there. Not the day where you come to join me, people will be no stay. For this war, before you come home. Anything where you see for this war, whether good or bad, make you take a son. And so everybody come in the world.
All right.
We get advice to say, any work where you get work, make you put your mind in. I work on my fight, make you not the talk like, make a yes, be yes. I know, we know, that you put it right on this one. Hey, hey, hey. So God bless you, keep your long life, keep your many, many birthdays again. So God bless you, keep your long life, keep your many, many birthdays again. Say thanks to you, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
All right, let's get a program rolling here. Happy birthday to Sis T. Oh, yeah. Yes, I have to do this. We gotta be gracious to people who impact our lives. She's a mother nun. You can consider her as a sister, sister. I remember those days way back, still in Tower Estate. I was staying with her. And then used to do, I can't put all out here because the liberal is listening. He's going to use that against me. So I'm not going to release some classified information. But I want to be gracious for this day, for her, this own sister. She's a mother since the old man passed away. There's the other sister there, Sister Rita. They are all here. So this is why the liberal is always jealous, because all my people are right here, are right in the middle. So his sister called me today and said, Fonso, you know why the liberal is always jealous of you? I'm fine. He used to live in Ohio, Kentucky, but he's now in Sacramento. But for me, going to work, I work in Massachusetts, right almost the border. My sister just like 5 minutes, Sister Rita, Sister Rita, all of that. I'm just in the middle. So anytime I can go rear, I can go front and get an emergency bill. But liberal, when he wants to get something, he got to get on the plane to leave Sacramento to go to Ohio. He get a gusto call today. Oh, that man is coming there. If he doesn't bring gift, I don't get anything. Really? Well, you got it wrong. My rice bread, my salad, and everything you think about, they are all loaded. Folks, welcome. I want to say it to Sister Rita, Sister Teresa, and all of our family members. After work today, spend some time with her. I almost, you saw me coming on program late today, right? Because I hammer dialed, stomach is charged. So if I fall asleep on this on live video today, just forgive me for that. We want to welcome our viewers and listeners across the globe. Our analyst, Jerry Backholm, is standing by, is LPR security analyst here. So hopefully the rest of the folks will be here. Jerry Sandy, welcome all our viewers. Just hit the share button and invite someone at your company. Thank you so much for those emojis, Fatima. Celebrating with us. This is what we should do. Maybe we need to introduce something, all of our viewers and followers here. If there's a unique day for you, let us know. I mean, sometimes Facebook gives those notifications. I know we could do it, but no, this is America. You got to get people consent to do something. So if there's some sort of memorable day coming for you as a family, as a group, as you know, whatever it is, that you see as a memorable day, let us know. We can cheer you. We can celebrate you for just taking up time to be with the boss here every day. Let me bring in Jerry Backholm, LPR security analyst right here in the Ocean State of Rhode Island. He's joining us, and the rest of the folks going to be here with us. We're going to be discussing some few things here. Of course, being not only a security analyst, he's also grounded into politics. Oh, we're going to empty all here. Mr. Barkham, good evening. Welcome. You know, those days when people get a sort of white beard and say, you back up Matthew, you this, that, but since the 20th century, the white beard, the white hair flowing all around. The good thing is natural. It's not all one thing where they got to pull, how they call it, say, they got to pull all kinds of chemical and to give it, make you to look like some kind of, you know, but it's natural. Good to have you, Mr. Bacon.
Thank you for having me. Nice. It's God's gift. It's wisdom. You know.
It comes to too much. It comes to too much darkness.
Too much pressure. That's one of the things.
So, you know, why should I do that? Because this just be a cause. Because the more you try to give it some sort of color, the more it comes and the more it gets stuff going. Okay, we're going to have an open mic here. There are a few couple of things here we're going to put on the table for conversation. And of course, you know now, for a little short term, the traditions, we always welcome our viewers, our listening audience, to all we are greater integers of our national conversation. But without me, based on your expertise, I'm going to shoot this video courtesy of Autotie Network inside Liberia. Let's see what happened, because the King George Massacre, that's how they turn it. You know, people die. People get so weird. People always had it. Yes, sis Rita, good to have you here. Playing the Bible song for your sisters and for all of us. We had a great time with her this evening here, but it's better late than never. Good to have you here. I'm blessed to have a very strong family that is very, very much supportive. Everything not rosy, but I can tell you, you know, we support one another. So let's play this video here, and we will have a conversation.
Today's protest. So, if you have been following the Liberal TV network, I guess recent weeks ago, there was a serious protest in Kunja that led to several human beings wounded, and also some lost their life in the process. So they are here to actually seek justice, and they are saying Dama Allen, who is the managing manager for the B Mountain Company, should leave because he is the key hindrance to all of the opportunities all of the opportunities the citizens should definitely get from King John.
Security. And so we are now calling
So guys, just to let you know why the protesters are coming, the police are trying to intervene. The police are here. We don't know exactly what would be the reaction from the police, because the protesters are trying to make their way. So there's the exact view of the Liberian National Police. As you can see, they are, some of them are standing and some of them are seated. They are in the
Okay, hey, Ciara, good to have you. Ciara's own sister, good to have you. I believe you are in Liberia. Hopefully the trip, everything went well. Good to have you back. Let's return to business here. You are a security analyst. What someone was thinking, who brought the OSA business in this politics of Liberia? You know where it came from? I thought of the men, but boy, guys, everybody, OSA.
I don't know the genesis. I would be lying to myself. I don't know how it came to be. I think it mostly based upon the struggles in Liberia, you know, they keep doing during the election. Yeah, so I don't know the genesis of it, you know, how it became popular so right now in Liberia.
We need to try to trace some of the...
Maybe somebody out there, you know, can come on the show or can give it a call and see, you know, the genesis of it.
It's a fair to say it's the creations of politicians, how to build up their base, their political base line of stuff. Because from 2017, but it got rampant, it was modified, they upgraded the system in the just ended elections. Literally every other day you will find some kind of song coming. Okay, those you saw that the recent King George, in fact, our correspondent went there, spent the whole day. I did an interview with folks there. Now we're seeing the visibly coming to light, coming in town, expressing their anger. In fact, we got a statement here. I got to put that in the chat room, their position statement and all of that. What is the security implications? All of it in the protesting, which of course is under the framework that is the constitution for people to protest, to exercise their constitutional right. But what is the downside of this? When you see this more or less becoming like a routine, you know, going to the mansions. The mansion, that should be, you know, that's the official residence of the president of the Republic of Liberia. It stresses governments, the security apparatus. You have to deploy people. You don't know who are coming. You don't know who bringing what. There's a danger involved. How can this be regulated?
Well, let's look at it from different perspectives. Hopefully it's in the continent. See, where there is protest, first, let's find the root. Why the people are protesting for? And why are the objective? And what do they want to accomplish? So all these things, as a security person, you have to take all the into the consideration that you just said. And the second thing you have to bear in mind is, who are these people? Where are they coming from? How they got organized? I think by now, the police, before any demonstration, at least there should be an intelligence. Okay, there should be an intelligence that will give you more details, their strength, the organizer, who are the leaders, and if possible, you can defuse them before they can even organize, not by incarceration, but you can, so they can make a negotiation, look.
So, okay, yeah, quickly, let's do it. This, sorry to interrupt you, but-
yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, this network is also a network of a learning process. We want our people to take away precise, not a guess game information. Oh, the man, the LPI analyst, they don't know the meaning of it. So let's break it down. When you talk about diffuse, what precisely are you saying?
Well, you see, if a demonstration is coming, if you get intelligence, you can, like the company that have the demonstration, where the people went and there was some casualty or some victims, some might have been victimized, and people were beaten, for example. Okay? So it is good for you to be proactive than to be reactive. The security system these days, we are more proactive than being reactive. Before then, we used to do the quote-unquote fire department mentality. Go and see where there's fire before you start putting water down. This time, you have to be proactive. Go on the scene. What happened? If the people want to demonstrate, if it's something that you can intervene, I want to say, if you want to intervene, look, I know y'all want to protest, or y'all want to do this, I want to demonstrate, but can we sit down
and have a conversation?
And have a conversation or have a dialogue. And that's what community policing is all about. And you know, community policing is not just go to the church or go to the, no. You have to be proactive. If there's an intelligence is coming to you or you got information, that's also something going to happen. As a leader, you intervene. Even if you cannot intervene, we have clergy members, we have community leaders, and because look, not everywhere police will go. Because sometimes if you wear a uniform, it distracts. Let me say distract. It attracts. You know, because when people see uniform, they want to be on camera, they want to be famous. 10-second Hall of Fame. So you can use the clergy, the community leaders, and say, look, this is what about to happen. We need your intervention, or we need for you to do something for us, because we, the police officer, or the army person, I'm not going to count that as a last resort. But we can use the community leader to reduce the tension.
So talking about to reduce, there's a book I've been reading recently called Deadly. And it talks about crisis and a lot of variety of some of the responsibilities of leaders, what they should be doing, how to curb and how to avoid crisis, because we are not good at managing crisis. And let me just put the, if I'm there wrong, just throw it right back in my face. Yeah. Recently, when this thing happened in Kenjo, there's a fatality already to report it. Series of press conferences were held. We human beings, we should also show the empathy side of us, how to empathize with situation. Not necessarily to sympathize, but empathize, because you know, you try to put yourself in their shoe, what they have gone through. I thought maybe the Minister of Information or even the police chief, when he was conducting those series of conferences, instead of being in the overall message, those who were inflicted, those who were directly affected during the crisis, perhaps they could have gone down to Cape Mount and host one or two conferences there and have a conversation. That will give you a sense of who the leaders are, and you will get to know more inner part of their potential plan, like you rightfully said, to have avoid this sort of protest. That did not happen. You, as a security person, do you think it could have been a good idea with the police chief who have gone to the scene itself? The scene more or less become a crime scene because their, you know, fatality was already reported, to have hosted a press conference or itself, is there another danger in itself going there? You think those people who have reacted differently? I'm seeing it from a different non-security world.
Yeah, I mean, these are good points. Let me go back. You see, it's depend on the leadership. Like you said, 1982-83, the scene came out. History might repeat itself. We had a mudslide or landslide
The Manor River.
In Manor River. But 30 or 40 some more years ago, the same thing happened. So you see, history is always teaches us. This is happening, 95% is going to happen again. I'm not saying Waka should go there, Mr. President should go there. But at a time when it happened, the president, Mr. Sanyang Kanyando, drove to the place. I'm not talking the magnitude. It doesn't matter whether or not one person died or two person died. The idea is a demonstration into the business area. And it also affect the community, because that's a business. People work there, people make their living. The president cannot go there. The Minister of Justice, the Minister of Information, that's why we have surrogates, or the Minister of Transportation, anybody from the cabinet for that matter, could have gone there, or the Minister of Labor, to speak with the authority to go and say, look, this is what's going on. The president understand what's going on, or the Minister of Justice could have gone there. So that's what I said. From the beginning, we need to be proactive in our community. Let me say something to our community. One of the things I observe is we do demonstration. And at the same time, let me go further a little bit. We go further that on the crime scene, they are being contaminated. You know, when there's a disease, we start demonstrating, and sometimes it's not effective for the police to do the crime scene investigation. The crime scene have been contaminated, people have demonstrated, and people have thrown rocks at the police. And sometimes we say, oh, the case went to court and the people didn't do no good prosecution, but because the crime scene have been contaminated. So we need to advise our citizens. It's your right, but when these things then go on, where there's a casualty, or not a casualty, that is, or somebody died, let's give the police a chance. Let them do a correct investigation. Well, very, very hard, as I see all the time.
Giving police a chance depends on what?
Let him do the investigation. You might not let him. You might not let the it takes time. It takes, look, police work is not guessing work. It's scientific. Any other police officer in the world, it's a 1 + 1 = 2. There's nothing you can do about it. It's a forensic. You are an accountant. You are a doctor. You are a counselor. You are a driver. You are a carpenter. As a police officer, because when you get on the crime scene, you have to be in charge. You have to get into people. You have to take that person to the hospital. You have, if there's a fire, you have to call fire department. So there are thousands of things that you, as a blunt police officer, have to execute all these things. So let's look. Police is all around the world. Police officers always have some repetition, but we do our best to work with the community. It's always the right. Give the police.
Let me put you in an uncomfortable position here. Say you were national security advisor to the president, President Jose Newman Boyka, and that sort of things, which is actually within the corridor of Mozzarella to Cape Mount, is easily accessible. Do you think you have been very bold to advise the president? Well, he just took seat. You want to maintain that rapport, that sort of leadership, be a strong leader, to maintain that relationship with the people, considering how the vote went. It was very narrowed, no questions about that. But to give the people reassuring, do you think the president should have gone there in person to say, look, I sympathize with you. I hear you. I know what you are going through. Investigations will be conducted. And people are sick and tired of these endless investigations without any result, only to come back to be the same old thing over and over. What is happening, there's a psychological part to that. People do the sort of, have the sort of flashback of things that happen. Look, this person was, this, so XYZ happened to this person. XYZ went on up to this time. No redress, no result. The case did not come to a closure. The person, those group become hopeless. Why do you think this time we're going to get a justice? All of these things factor in the heads of the people and the outburst surface. So do you think the president who have gone there, perhaps to stabilize the tensions and give the people reassuring, you know what, things happened two, three years ago. We never saw the president going there, but this president coming here, we're going to hold our breath in our chest and see what happens next.
Okay. Now, you put me in the first thing is, as a national security advisor to the president. First of all, as a national security advisor to the president, the first thing I would do as a national security advisor to the president, call the county attorney, who is the chief legal officer within that county, or the district attorney, see what actually happened, to brief me before I, as a security advisor to the president, go to the president and say, Mr. President, here, this is what's going on. This is what happened. And if possible, he can call the National Security Council. The National Security Council, based upon the National Security Council, I will make my recommendation. Mr. President, I think at this time, it is necessary be the consular in chief who will control the people. And it will be a debate within the National Security Council. When you talk about National Security Council, it's composed of different branches of security, and we will have that discussion. But you see, we have to make an impact in our society, especially when it comes to death. Cases have not been solved. And people have been murdered, raped, businesses burned down, and there's no redress. So that's also on our mind, our security, the trust. You asked me the question the other day, I think it was Sunday? Yes. And it still resonated with me. Your question was, why is it that they always labeled the security forces with the president? And I'm still trying to do a research. You know, like the Dole police, Tubman police, Toba police, all the president police.
Helen Johnson, CDC police.
Yeah, CDC police. So these are things, because once that thing, it becomes a labor theory. And how do we change it from the laborer mind? How we as a professional individual, how can we give the assurance to all the people and say, look, we are here, the uniform that I'm wearing is yours, the car that I'm driving is your tax money, and you will get redressed. So we need to get confidence, restart building confidence within our people in the country. So these are some of the things we need to start working on, especially from a law enforcement perspective.
So quickly here, is there some sort of gap here? Instead of the government leaders taking the government to the people, they align the people to come to the government, because if these people have issues, they have things to address, the leader should be able to intercede promptly to go there and say, hey, in fact, go to where the actions, let them see your bravery, let them see the other side of you, let them feel that the government is with them. But in most cases, we said officials sit far from the distance. They have no idea what physically really happened, to rely on second-hand information and give these sort of conflicting information that are not even correct as well. That upset people as well, because they feel they are not feeling the presence of their government.
Precisely. This is what happened. From the conversation we have, I say we need to be proactive instead of be reactive. These days, I just want to pull it like I'm teaching the class, I'm in the classroom right now. The studio you're in, or the house I'm in right now, maybe. Let's use the analysis on prevention. In my house right now, there's a smoke detector. Why there's a smoke detector? Because if there's a fire, it will alarm me and say there's a fire. So the insurance company try to save money. For that reason, we'll say before your house is do something, we have to have smoke detector. I mean, I just want to put this a little understanding.
Right.
Yeah. So we need to engage the community. This is what we need to do as a law enforcement officer. I'll put myself in a law enforcement perspective. I mean, that's my area. So I always say we. I mean, because I mean, Liberia, I'm not working for the government. So let me make it clear. But as a law enforcement person, anything that's go wrong, people will always come and ask Jerry why this is happening. But we need to be proactive. The thing here is conspiracy. Because if the government did not speak out within 24 hours or address the media or what's going on, look, we have two dead. We are doing our investigation, we will have something. But if you wait two, three days before you start speaking out, you know what? You are create a vacuum.
And people are going to feel in that vacuum.
Thank you. People will start throwing different real conspiracy theories. Oh, the government covering up, the government is doing it, the police went there, quote unquote, they shot the person, even maybe the police have never even fired a gun. But because the person is deceived, and these are conspiracy. And it's especially the media days we are living. Once it's been put on the social media, you know, people will act and subtract. So our responsibility. The first thing is defuse the crowd. Once you defuse the crowd, you call a press conference and say, look, we understand this is what happened. And we will get to you people as soon as possible. Or, look, I'll say this. I'm not trying to promote myself, but I wrote a proposal some years ago. And I said, see, we have 15 counties, okay? We need to have three assistant directors that will control the other 15 counties so that when things happen before, it can get to the director of police who in Monrovia, if we have like Cayman in the west, I think about five counties in the west, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Bongkandi, Cayman,
You have
Babadu and all the whole nine. Yeah. So that director would be the first, the face they will see, eh? That there is authority is there, even though her county commander, but he is a high hierarchy. So when he is there as an assistant director, we do it in the United States. The FBI. Hold on one second.
Mm-hmm.
The FBI. They have assistant director in the Northeast that control the New England states. So they don't have to go to Washington or Gay before. No, the assistant director will be able to inform the proper director. So we can do this thing. We can do this thing.
When you say you wrote a proposal to, for clarity and to get across here, let's welcome a man, Vandela Patricks, I formerly contested in Mangibia. So we need to get a story of how it went and what your next move. That will be a different time. But when you say you wrote a proposal, the proposal, to whom it was directed precisely?
Well, first, I sent it to the outgoing government. It was sent to the APCO. Yeah, it was sent to the CDC government.
CDC government. Was it delivered?
Yes, sir.
Who delivered it?
Well, for security reasons, I cannot review it. At appropriate times, I will let you know to whom it was given.
To whom it was delivered?
Yes.
To whom it was delivered?
Yeah, the first thing I was appropriate time. Okay.
Yes, sir. Police,
I don't want this to get in the wrong hand or somebody else will read it now and say, okay, this is what the person is and stuff. That's for that reason. I can take it, I give it to the individual.
So you yourself deliver it or someone proxy your affairs?
I personally deliver it.
I guess to the police commissioner.
No. The hierarchy more than the police. More than the police.
The Minister of Justice?
No, sir. I cannot review it, sir. I can't review the person I gave it to.
My job is to ask you.
It was given to somebody in the past government. I gave it to the person in the past government.
Is the person still alive?
Yeah, they stay alive.
Are they currently serving in government?
That's where the government the new government just came to power, but.
There are still items in positions pending confirmation.
I just gave it to one of the hierarchy individuals in the government. I gave it to them at a time what we wanted to do. But anyway.
Okay, let's make progress. Mm-hmm.
These are the things some of us need to work on. Look, today the crime rate in our country is very high. Things have changed. First of all, the unemployment is very high. Where you find unemployment, if you expect some of these things to happen. So we need for to be proactive, especially when it comes to death. It's one of the things people are angry. So we have to be proactive, my brother. It is not a joke. Police work is not a joke. It's a sign. It's a scientific work. It's a science work. It's not really just put on a uniform. It's a sign of work.
Do you think my guess here, and they are very police, and the police is challenged. So, you know, this is a very convoluted one, very
hard. We'll say police is in a general term, you know, because we got different security. And we just say the police, but maybe we just say police all the time. You know, all the security, everybody and all the things. But we just say police. We can put anything. Immigration or NSA, these are all police signs.
So I'm making direct reference to the Liberian National Police. Is that okay?
Yeah, quite.
Okay. So I believe then, and it should be now, that there are different police detachments with commanders. And fair to say, we all know police. There are some counties they don't even have motorbike before I talk about even patrol car. All of these are contributing factors And we have the first branch of government, both the lower and the upper. And there are committees in charge responsible. You know, I know we frown on the security apparatus that includes the immigration, other plainclothes, and the immigration, how you call it, the NSA, even the DEA, and all of that. These are all security apparatus that constitute to be joint security. My guess, with my limited knowledge, I know they do share information and all of them. But when you talk to them and when you see for yourself, they do not have the logistic. That itself makes it very difficult. It, like you say, you are an army man, but your hands shrinking that day, you're going to war. So how are you going? Even if you can get the best bulletproof, how can you counteract the enemy that coming to you? I'm saying this to say, for example, if we have enough manpower, maybe, you know, Monrovia can beat up Senate or something, but perhaps press a conference could be held there to be able to give people the precise idea, because those are the people on ground. They witness it. They know how the episode took place. They might have gotten some intelligence, because these things, it's not just automatic. I don't think people just went there overnight. There was something that was happening. There was something that triggered this whole thing to get it to for us to see the outburst. They ordained the one to address it. We don't see that. And like you rightfully said, and most of these people that are in charge, they got their education from here. Let's put aside the resources. What is the problem of vent? Even if they do not, well, we can see here, when something happens here, they will not give all of the details, but they are obligated to keep the public, to keep their citizens up to date. This has happened. It's an active, ongoing investigations. We keep you in. You see sometimes in those routinely press conference is going to be going on to update people. But it doesn't happen. This is what also get people upset. Like, their government reject them. Nobody have time for them. They are on their own. And when people feel that they are on their own, potentially they take the law into their own hands.
First of all, ask a question to all citizens. It is your right to demonstrate, but it is not your right to destroy property. Look at that street. The second thing we need to take into consideration is, as a leader, it is your responsibility to defuse the situation. Like you said, if something happened, like say somebody get murdered in nuclear or downtown Greater Monrovia right now, it is our responsibility, when I'm talking to the law enforcement perspective, we just discovered this is a thing. We want a citizen to be calm. This is what we are doing. You don't have to go in detail, but you want to reduce the tension. Because you see, if you don't reduce the tension, it's going to cost you more money or more manpower. Because when there's a riot coming, you have to deploy men from, put the other men from the other resources and put our men into that area. So the best is, like I said from the beginning, we don't do fire department anymore in law enforcement. They say, oh, wait until it happens. No, this time we have to be proactive. Yeah, one of the things we need to take into consideration. People, I'm thinking about a scenario that happened the other day, and the police was kind of, oh, okay, fine. During the election, the incoming Vice President Kennedy, Mr. Jeremiah Coon, the current Vice President, and senior senator from Nima County, they are requested that they needed a protection because they are getting some information that something was going to happen. Thank God, you know, there's no casualty or there was no death, but there was a discharge of fire. Based upon this thing, you have to be active. Whether it's a false information But you have to verify this thing. You cannot say that, look, the time it takes to respond is important. Like you just said. Your police department. Look, what happened in Buchanan 2022 or 2023 in St. John River there, by St. John River. They burned down the police depot. Because of angry crowd. By the time they go from Buchanan to bring manpower, the damage had already been done. So with every police station, even in the Green United States, even that one person in that police station, they are all qualified. They get a crown lap. They got everything that a police, that 201 police officer needs. So I always say, in order to make money, you got to spend money.
Okay, well, that's
one. If you want to put one law enforcement in our country, we have to spend the money. We have to spend the money. First, we need to train our manpower. Look, let me give you another example. Yes, a police officer who graduated from the police academy maybe 2 years ago. They sent him to the any part of Liberia. Let's say, Bagleville. Because that's the any part of Liberia. He had gone to Bagleville and stayed for 2 years. No training. Okay. He just graduated from the police academy and said, okay, you know what? You went back there. That's the assignment. Great. She got that. No in service again. He probably not even get a platoon. He might not even get a flashlight. So when things happen, where do you expect a police officer
to try?
To survive. Or where do you get a backup? You must say we're in the Great United States before a police officer. Even if you get a I know there's another German. If a police officer they call and they suspect you to have a suspended lesson, there will be a backup before that police officer. He will get out of her car or his car before it's the procedure.
Okay. So let's welcome Ceci Goyard. Two change agents slash what? LPR analyst, or you still on a change agent?
I'm on a sabbatical from LPR analysis. After the asset recovery team get our Kawatio bar and get a national jury bar from Julie Andy, then I'll be back. Hey, how are you doing, Mr. Barco?
I'm doing great. Nice to see you, sir.
We're going to come to the asset recovery. There are other institutions calling for the dissolution of the team, the president. For I don't know.
If they only do one thing for the disorder, I'll be happy. Then they get our county back from Sazan Kawa. Then we'll be good.
Your county, you want to.
It's a national county. The national asset.
So I can give my own to you.
I said the one for the nation.
Okay. Okay, so it's good to have you here. We're filling in the gap here for the liberal progressive. And this is coming in because of what we saw happening. And and they were not security for security reasons. Even when we talk about the police chief, they can't tell you precisely the strain. But I think there is a need, considering what our country and the world time has involved significantly in this 21st century, with the proliferations and the beauty, the advantage and disadvantage of the social media also impact people's way of doing things. I think there should be the time has come to invest heavily in the security apparatus, especially the police, not just only the police, even the immigrations and all of that. Those are people at our borders, the people we don't know who coming. So we are surrounded by other three countries, people goes in, come in, different nationalities, Liberians, we don't know who these people hang out with, and all of that. Do you think government should take a look now to prioritize the security of the country? The country, I'm not saying only Monrovia, but I'm saying the country. But what happened, we saw what happened in Grenada, for example, burn down police station. Sometimes they don't have the logistics. The people want to do it, but the citizen can protesters overpower The strength of the police, one, because they do not even have the logistics to even say they're going to do any sort of thing to push back. How can this thing be addressed, my man?
So I listened to Mr. Barker and I was really impressed by a lot of things he said. And that's why I came out. Actually, doing my usual daddy duty this time of the night. But look, I think across our sensitive government institutions, there has to be a beef up of employment and retraining and constant in-service training. Look, this is where when people come to power, and I'm talking about from Ellington to downsizing and adding their own people to the CDC to harmonizing and adding a bunch of people, when you hear about the padding of government payrolls, you never hear about they hire more police, they put more people on immigration payroll, they put more, they're putting people in places that we don't need them.
Finance.
Right. So if you really want to add government payroll, put more police. Bad, get more immigration. Get more teachers. You hardly can hear the people getting the power to hire more teachers, so we vet. The people getting the power to hire more police, so they never ever do that. I don't know why.
It's more nurses. Why are they doing that?
And that's the problem. I don't know, Mr. So, if I knew, I read a book and be a millionaire. I think this is time the rescuers need to start looking at things differently. We need more police officers. Look, initially the idea of the Liberian National Police and the reason we got these subdivisions, again, our system has failed, is each of these, like Monrovia, for example. You got Monrovia City Police. They were supposed to be a supplemental arm to the National Police in Monrovia. The Liberian National Police was almost like the FBI, right? Overseeing all counties. But these cities are all supposed, you go to Pinsbury and Pinsbury has to invest in the police. You know, the only thing they can do, harass the market woman and all they can do.
The world of market nugget.
All the men and we have already in the beginning fighting one motorbike. That is it.
Sister, please, we want to laugh here. I don't want to sleep again.
They begin to be fighting all day. You see the men's uniform.
They don't even care. They don't report it. Where you get for the officer?
The men are wash your uniform, even the one color the uniform is anymore. Right. But this is not funny, though. I think we need to go back to that. If the city of Kakata has a detachment and the city is responsible for recruiting and retraining that detachment, and the city of Banga, we don't have to do it every small city, but like Bikina, Banga, Sanikuli, and those major cities should have a detachment that is well armed and well staffed. I think that's where we start from, because you can't have Liberian National Police running from Monrovia to go all the way to Swaziland to put a fire. You know?
Yeah. Okay, Terry, good evening. Welcome.
Yeah, good evening to the panel.
Yeah, I don't know what we are improving or this. Would they get a song? They used to have a funny song here during Tilago. They threw all way back. I remember
1976.
As far as Sando County, the police major that were there at that time, when police moving, I mean, the guys, the way they dress, their uniform, I mean, they properly attired. You know, you see them moving. We are in this modern century. Why is our governments, all of the, from the Helen Johnson, the most Harvard trained economies. And what sister said, our security apparatus seems to be the most least.
And real quick before Collins come in, like I was about to learn before the woman came in, look at the Bureau of Immigration. You have more immigration officers in the capital than at our borders. A sign in Monrovia. For what reason?
Yeah, I would do that.
Tell me for what reason?
Money.
You know, They all want to be in town and, you know, asking people for the resident permit, hold it, running down people there. Why are you having more people in the capital for immigration than at the borders? So I think, you know, Mr. Bachman's making a point. The NSA, the NBI, all of those people probably have branches in the major capitals. And they're operating from there. You know, just like the police, the teachers themselves don't get retraining. Once you become a teacher, they're done with you. When we don't recruit for those. So, Mr. Barker, I really appreciate the perspective you brought on. You made me to come on because I was really liking the way you were going. I'll just sit and listen more.
Okay, let's bring in Tarela. He's the strong voices. And this is what we do here. We discuss it here. And by the way, you established your identity the other day, right? You're a supporter of who? Back on, just because these guys are not here. Let me let it get your own baby. We say you don't fall humble.
I'm independent.
No, the line you, Mr. Bacon said he was CDC, he left back to DC.
No. Listen, no. This is what I said. Okay, let go ahead. No. Give our brother friends. You just come in.
No, Mr. Bacon, go ahead. Explain yourself.
I told you, these guys are here. They are like cameo appearances that going on in the Lions' den. Don't mind them. So when they ride a flame, it can be easy.
No. Let my brother speak first, then I will follow him. Let me give you the opportunity.
On a serious note, but so then, Terry, let me just bring you on this whole thing here. Because we can talk about the police not do this, the police not do this. There is a branch of government too that is responsible, you know. They are responsible. It's not just only with the executive. And this is the most troubling thing here. The people, the 103 men and women, who are in the habit of escorting other appointees to go take office, if they could just use some of those free time that they have and say, oh, I'm a senator from Bapolu. I'm a senator from Bone County. How many police officers, how many police are in Bone County? Let's look at a geographical setting of Bone County. For the last 1 year, 2 years, the population, as the population grows, the more the population grows, the possibilities of crime and everything kind of like beat up. Okay, do we have a pickup even in that play there? How many districts in Bone County? Can we make some sort of allotment that at least every district have a police pickup and have some sort of good detachment that if there's anything happened to this other district, Bone County should be the central. I can remember those days, Bone County. This is painful. This is painful. And you have these men and women who lack the judgment, common sense. They don't care. They prefer to ration money among themselves. 30,000 giving them development, whatever fund. They don't have no office. They don't do anything when election coming. Then they turn to Chinese people. They want to get things done overnight. But yeah, we front on the police. It's a time for us to redirect our conversation to the people. Wait a minute. How much? Since you were here, since the other day, not just only the police, the education. We heard a Monrovia consolidated school system. They just make budget and throw it to you without even giving you the opportunity to say how much it costs to have a quality, to run the quality institutions, well effective. But they make it, they throw it to you. They ain't give you no chance, they say manage. That's a recipe for corruption and chaos. That's the kind of society that we are running. Terry, why are people behaving like that?
Well, Mr. So, I think there are several factors involved, challenges and all that. For example, like most of the, for the House, I will not blame them much, even though I will blame them.
Don't talk right here, Terry. Don't say
it. The reason I blame them, Mr. So, but I will not blame them too much because we are the one who put them there. You put people in power who don't know what to do. What do you expect? They will just steal. That's what happening because obviously, most of the people in the House don't know what to do.
They said, you will carry on. But let's see here. It said that they don't know what to do or their action deliberate.
Ms. Osu, most of the people in the house do not know what to do. Take, for example, right? Ceci, I think, is an educator. You put men like Nathaniel McGee as head of a committee over education in the house. How far you expect it to go? Knowing that Nathaniel McGee is a politician, you got to first evaluate what did he study? What is his career? What is Nathaniel McGee's career? What he studied in school? What he got his degree in?
Find another person as a case study in the interest of fairness.
You understand that? Darius Dillon. You make Darius Dillon
foreign affair committee.
What do he know about that?
Why are you talking about Nathaniel McGee who can spare on him, but Darius Dillon who can spare on?
Because he said I should look for a different person.
No, I'm saying you're of fairness.
You help him make the spare on McGee, but you want to help him spare on Darius Dillon.
So I think people, not that they are not educated in certain areas, but they are educated in areas wherein they are not actively working. So this is the reason why we're having problems in being able to address these major issues in our country. But with all fairness, the police will always have problems, as the teachers will always have problems, because we don't have rules. We don't have a means to for these police guys to go into various villages and be able to address some crimes that are committed. There are heinous crimes that are committed in those villages, Mr. Soul, that are far from security protection. All right? Somebody will just jump out and just cut their wife into pieces. It will take 1 week before it reaches to the city where you can find a security or agency to relay that information before you even see one journalist. So the war seems to have sent us backward, and we are in a place where it seems like we are never coming from. Like you guys talk about dual time, what we call normal days. And even though we were younger at the time, but those were the days we still up to now refer to as normal days. Why? Because in those days, the economy was good. $1 could buy you plenty of things. But look at our situation now, it's not so. And in those times, Liberia was just progressing. Like say always talk about data, the number of population we have was like 2 to 3 million people in a very huge country, in a very big country. So obviously the population, the economy could meet the demand of the population. So as a result, Liberia was not in this kind of a heinous condition, as the way it is as we see. Right now, the population have increased, and it seems like more of the load, the population have transgressed the load on Monserrato County, thereby leaving bulk of the county empty because there is no resources to provide and all of these things. So as a result, most of the security apparatus feel that the only way they can survive is to be in Monserrato County, because this is where the pie is. This is where the money is flowing. So the rest of the other places, nobody want to go. Nobody want to go sit down to a border wherein you will see in one day, you will get only about 10% coming in with few goods. How much money are you going to generate from there? You're not going to get much. But you know that when you sit in Monserrato, in one lay boot, in Rayleigh, before you leave from that place, you will be making at least about 1,000 to 2,005 every day as a police officer. So which job you will prefer? So the police guys are lobbying to not go to certain places because they know they will not get anything from there. You understand? So these are challenges. That's why I tell you the other day that the police is challenged. They are not corrupt. They are challenged. Because the man that I believe is corrupt are those who making the millions that we're talking about, those who in the house, they're making 100,000 per year, but they stay stealing. Those are the people that are corrupt. You understand? Mm-hmm. So there are many, many factors that will factor into this, what we're trying to present here, that will hinder the police or any security apparatus, even the teachers for that matter, because some of those teachers are walking. Like I was, when I was doing Go Business, we used to walk like, sometimes we used to walk like 8 hours in the jungle. 8 hours you walking. Who the security or the teacher will be walking that kind of distance to go, just to go teach one school, and how much you gonna get from there? So with all of these being said, these are the challenges that I think our government need to address. And poorly, with $600 million budget, you will not be able to address this, all these factors evenly. And at the end of the day, if you steal money from, if you steal any money, it will affect. That's the reason why everybody cry in the country, because you got a $600 million budget and only few people controlling the $600 million. And the few people that controlling this money, they are stealing the money over it. So as a result, the little that have been allocated for those budgets, that little is not even feeding the budget that is allocated for. So I see these are some of the challenges I think, Mr. So, that it's going to be difficult for us to move our country forward.
Okay. We'll shift gear quickly, but let me bring in Mr. Bakum.
Yeah, I mean, thank you so much, brother. Look, there are so many factors that we can deal with. Let's look at the teachers. They trickle down to the police again. When I was growing up, there was competition between us. You wanted to go on a roll. When you go to school, you want to see a knee on a bulletin. Maybe I might be older than you a little bit, but there was competition. The student wanted to participate in student government. Look at our education system today. It's triggered because, look, the child who does not have education, sorry to say, they end in poverty, they have a child. That child, what end up doing? Recycle the poverty. They end up in a crime. Or they have a child. That child end up in a juvenile cycle. Are what you following me?
Mm-hmm.
And this, I think, so our teachers today, they are underpaid. They are not even prepared. Some of our teachers are not prepared to be a teacher. Before you began a teacher in Liberia, then when I was going to school, you don't go to ZTR or KRTTR. You have to graduate from one of the renowned institutions before you become a teacher. Now today, I don't want to take all your time, but here's the thing. When I was in Monrovia, everything was decentralized. If you were in the recruiter, because I grew up in the recruiter, I went to a scene. When I graduated from Tubman Elementary School, you either go to Boston Junior High or you go to Monrovia to go to school. That's how the school system was set up. Before the Bay Detour, Tubman High, you know what Tubman High before they call Detour. So if you graduated from that, if you can't go to Boston Junior High, you don't go to Newport Junior High. So the system was set up. Today, look at where we are. The system is broken down. If you are in Central Monrovia, you don't go to Tubman High. If you don't go to Tubman High, you go to Charatoba Memorial Academy. If you didn't go to Charatoba Memorial Academy, you will go across the bridge. So we knew, or you go to Pinsway Public School. So even if you wear a uniform, as soon as they see you in that uniform, they know where you were. Let me get the three up. 1 second. Mr. Mastron, Mr. Teofilo Sompon. Thank you. These are people, when you see them in the street, when you see them in the street, there was influential. You're scared. Today, where are we?
The late Rosetta Harris.
What the lady name from Kerry Street, demonstration school, Mrs. Wissing. These are people, even if you go waterside, you best behave, she hold your ear. Which school you coming from?
I beg you, if you hold your ear, they will slap you. I said a group now, and then you hold your ear, you're in trouble.
But look what we have today, my brother. Look at what we have today. You and myself, we only national people watching you from all over the world because of the education we had. The discipline we have today, there's no way around.
Let's take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back.
Hello, welcome to Uncle Musa Grocery, 6523 Woodland Avenue in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
I'm a customer of Uncle Musa. I came here to get some things from grocery. Their things are so nice. They never get expired. They are the best quality. They have the best price ever anyone can get. They have so many things like cream, like meat, a lot of kind of meat. We have so many kind, and it's the best grocery store I've ever seen here in Woodland. We are located at 65th and Woodland. If you want, I really appreciate you guys to come over to come and patronize with us because they sell the best quality.
Uncle Musa's Groceries on Woodland Avenue, 6523 Woodland Avenue, Philadelphia, PA. Musa's store is composed of varieties of African food as well as Americans, but predominantly African food. You have dry fish, you have cassava, you have yams, you have plantains, bananas, and Musa even goes out of his way to pay people extra to cut the potato grains for customers to save them extra time. We have fufu, we have the refrigeration center, then we also have cosmetics. This is the place to come in Philadelphia. If you come to Philly, you don't reach to Uncle Musa's Groceries, you have not made your trip complete. Welcome, and we look forward to seeing you sponsoring our business. Thank you.
This is Uncle Musa's store, 6523 Woodland Avenue. It's the only store, a grocery store, that deals with African stuff. Anything African thing, you can get in Uncle Musa's store. I am from Igbo, in Nigeria. So, in the Igbo dum, onye obula wo onye Igbo, ya bia na Uncle Musa's store, 65.
All right. Store. Let's bring you this community announcement here. That's the Barbie District Association, Barbie Development Association, if you will. I will be hosting an inaugural program right here in the ocean state of Rhode Island, right here in my own state. Oh man, this Saturday is going to be really, really a big one. That is the inaugural ceremony of Mr. Evan Tabawi, a member of his team. The program is expected to take place right here at on Capitol Hill, Jefferson Boulevard. If you are within the New England Belt and it's a corridor, please, whether in Minnesota, you can come and let's chill. It's going to be a big, big one. All right. So contact the organizer. You can reach out and we will also let you know. Let's go right back to our panelists here. We're going to shift gears. Pop quiz here. Tomorrow is what? In Liberia, Terry?
It's the Inauguration Day, right?
I ask you a question. You ask me.
Because so you're very critical. Anyway, tomorrow is Inauguration Day.
Inauguration Day. Okay, so we got to take a retrospect. LPR team went out today. I think we in this business yet.
Oh, yeah, you guys did a great job.
And they will be going out tomorrow again. We need to visit every sector. The functionary or functions of government is not only teacher nexus. We need to look at every sector. Let's look at this.
Yes, this thing today brought tears to my eyes.
This is a cemetery in the heartbeat of the Republic of Liberia. And just let us imagine, let's put aside is not comparing apples with oranges, for common sense, for God's sake, people lost one, father, mothers, daughters, sons, this is where they were buried. Let's play this video here, courtesy of LPR Code and our man, Tanner James Carver did an extraordinary job, and we're going to have a conversation here on some of how terrible our society is. Let's really see.
Well, folks, we are here. Are you doing that?
They don't even say, come here to you to say, oh, I recorded.
Look how are you?
Look at how you're living paid. If I don't come here to clean it, nobody can come, man. Okay? You left your property. They get a whopping, thousands of dollars. They don't even say, oh, tomorrow decoration day. They don't even care. All they know to what you built to collect rent for it and reaching themselves. Yeah, what has been great there? Your party grave there. All of them in America. Just suffer for the property on get a seat. They start the property. Young boy winner. Great. Your party great. Everything.
So folks, this fellow met him here at his loved one grave. He's expressing dissatisfaction over how the conditions of this place is. The Center Street Cemetery. He's saying a lot of things. As you can see, this is how the cemetery is. We want to say kudos to the Moravia City Corporation who are taking the initiative to have this place cleaned up. But it was not, as you have seen it, it was very, very bullshit, matter of fact. But you can see here, the Moravia City Corporation have given this place a facelift prior to the decoration day on tomorrow that will be observed by thousands of Liberians in and across of Liberia. So tomorrow, relatives who will be coming here will find it much easier to commute their way through those very graves. This is it.
Okay, gentlemen, you know, this is a kind of thing. Are you not hearing me? Are you hearing me, Susan?
Yeah, I'm hearing you.
Okay, I think maybe Terry wasn't hearing me. This is kind of like painful. That's the Moravia Center Street cemetery there. You heard a gentleman talking. And as a matter of fact, like the reporter, because if you to go way down to the video, people from the city corporation making an attempt to do some cleaning. I don't know. This whole thing started from Helen Johnson, Salif. They were talking about relocations. I don't know what was the real contingency plan. What was the real thing? What a government really did for people to remove their people, but it had to get to the detail. But Terry, when you see that and you get a loved one, tomorrow is decoration day. We have what we call Memorial Day here, where when that day comes, you know, we memorialize our deceased loved ones. You go there, you sit, you know, but what do you do there? Is that a guy, the gentleman there?
Yeah, it's heartbreaking. And what took my attention also is the pile of dirt across opposite the grave, across the street. You know, that is whole Center Street, you know, is just dilapidated. It's disgusting, actually. And I think the boys, they used to break the grave and use the dead bones. I know something they say they used to use to smoke from the human bones or so. I don't know how true it is. But I think that is why most of the graves are busted, because those Zogos used to sleep in the grave and do a lot of crazy stuff. But unfortunately, the government is not really taking responsibility over these things. especially the past government, because I would not want to throw somebody blame GMB now because he's just coming in. But that place is very, very bad, Mr. So. And I think we really need to bring somebody on that understands what's going on, especially the city mayor. I don't know if that falls in the city mayor's, you know, jurisdiction, but that place is, it does not look good at all. And today when that guy started to do that thing, I was very shocked, because most of the time I'm always around that area when I go to Liberia. There are family members.
Not only that cemetery, all over Monrovia. And wow. Trust me, when you go to places, a spot almost at 1300, 1400, but people, the community, they say they're the one taking care. I think people should be held responsible for these things. People pay their family, people pay money to bury, to lay their people to rest.
Yeah.
When people get the money, apparently they go and drink, and that's it. Nobody going to put any cover, nobody going to put anything there to clean again until family, to the extent that even during the when you go there, you can't even have people because
and they charge exorbitantly for even spots. And I don't think Center Street can take any more. So most of the graveyard now, it's outside Monrovia, like it's around. You go to Carwell, they got graves in Carwell, about 2 to 3 different cemetery. You go to the other place, Tinker Village, they got graves and all that. So they're going outside the city now, and sooner or later, so people just take money from people and they are not doing anything. So I don't know if there's a means to reprimand people for all these things. I don't know what the criteria, I don't know what the city mayor is doing. You know, I really don't understand, but it's not looking good on Monrovia.
Yeah, we are making the arrangement with the city corporation. These are all on whether it is gonna say the corporations or other autonomous agency or ministry, but I definitely believe city corporation. Somebody somewhere in government should have oversight responsibility. Sissy, are you there?
I'm here.
So these are all filters in government. What were the plans put in place? How other government and people just don't care. Imagine your daughter, your wife, or some immediate relative, or somebody was laid to rest in that place. How that place is looking like. Why should we have this kind of thing like this? And people, government officials, people drive through to see those places. Lawmakers, everybody, and nobody is doing anything about it. And not just only that, just before you come in, if you see all the other cemetery, you can't have assets. And you pay like $1,300, $1,400, even if you want to go like a Muslim or whatever you want to do, that's how they charge you. But guess what? It is only families that are going to clean those places. Our guys will do everything. They're going to be in the field again tomorrow to bring us some image. Why is it like that?
Well, I see a myriad of problems here. First of all, it is disrespectful and very heartbreaking to disrespect the dead and other people's loved ones like that. The woman who raised me, my mom that I talked to you about, who took me from the village, had one son, only one son, and he passed, and they buried him on Center Street. And people started burying over the grave. Gradually, we started losing there. People started breaking into graves around there. That woman living with that grief of losing her only son she ever had to find money to go and exhume the remains of her own. Had to go to exhume the remains on her own to take it to Lofa. We were buried in Lofa from Center Street because we're afraid of exactly what we're seeing right now. Graves are busted. I was hearing some stories that people are smoking dead body bones and all kinds of stuff. So on that level is very disgusting, but I see multiple failures in there. Government, I don't think it's in the business of running cemetery, and it should not be, but it should regulate it. If it's going to be in private hands, there should be regulation. There's one industry that we have failed to regulate in Liberia. People still bury in there, and some people pass out their dinner because they don't want to take their loved ones places that they would be disrespecting yet. And there are these private cemeteries now around Monrovia. But what is the regulation? What's the regulatory agency responsible for them? Like you said, Mr. So, for ensuring that they're keeping those places clean. You go pay your money, you leave, you come to America, and nobody there at the end of it. Somebody might even end up setting that same spot for somebody to bury away a loved one. So you really need to think about the government end has to be the regulation. Who is responsible? What's the regulatory arms? What is the condition that is laid out? I saw that they're now talking about regulating beauty saloons and barbershop, which is good, cosmetology. But who is looking at, if there is a regulatory agency, how do we look back at the laws and make sure that we are tightening it so that stuff that happened in Central Street does not happen in other places? And what is the plan? I understand they say the current city mayor clean up the place, and I almost laughed when he said the place looking better now. And I said, whoa, are they better there? I hate to see it before they clean it up.
Oh, yeah. The whole Central Street, when you're driving, you just got to go up because the whole street.
Listen to the being in the guy's voice also is also personal. Right. He's talking about other people who benefited from this dead person who has abandoned them in death. And so that pain was on so many levels for me. I felt that brother pain on so many levels. It's abandonment from family. It's abandonment from government. It's abandonment from people who are responsible to take care of that place. So I think the government needs to look into that. Ellen King, and she put in some policy, but it's on paper. Now we got to get it to where there's actually an action. Everybody agrees that place needs to be relocated. But there has to be a way to relocate them with dignity. We're not just going to take a bulldozer and bulldoze over people's family bones and stuff. There has to be a proper way to exhume those bodies and relocate them. But overall, my really policy prescription is that the same people that are looking at Social Security, Social Security and Welfare Corporation, are looking into retirement, they ought to be looking into death. Because if we truly want to honor our people when they work throughout, and we're looking at their pension, which is good, we also should be looking at how are we disposing of them in a respectful manner. It can't just be you work, you die, we're done with you. Or you work, and you retire, you die, we're done with you. And this is an issue. I actually saw that brother today. I thought about that boy, my brother today. And this is one issue that I'm going to take on. We can joke around with Zaza Kawa, but this is an issue that Liberian people got to take on. And this is going to be one of my things. I'm going to jump behind people for these few days, and we'll make sure we find somebody that will answer to us on what is the plan forward, because that is just disrespectful. That is just hurtful. That is just painful.
Joe, Mr. Bako?
Yeah. I'm very sympathetic. You see, the national government had a responsibility to regulate the dear brothers there. But the thing is that we have to come to the local government. We have to come to the local government. You see, our government system is cool, it's one of the best. We got a central government, we got a local government, but we have to neutralize what we have. Brothers and sisters, look, here you are. If I want anything, I in the city of Pawtucket, in Rhode Island, I go to the city hall. I get anything that I want. Leave my house. If I want the original owner of the house, I can go to city hall tonight or tomorrow morning. I would know who was the first person that owned the house. You want married tomorrow morning, you go to city hall. So we need to localize this thing for the local government to take over. The central government is the central government, but we need the local government to be effective. If you want anything to get done in this country, the local government have to be effective. Because everything we have to come to Monrovia, folks, it's a waste of time. I don't want to deviate a little bit. You want passport, you got to come to Monrovia. You want driving lesson, you got to come to Monrovia. You want this, you got to come to Monrovia. So then what is the purpose of the local government? What is the reason of we having a local government? So we need to empower the local government. She is responsible to regulate cemetery. Beside Center Street in Monrovia, name me one county that the government allocated and said, this is the cemetery for this county here. Name me one county. Maybe somebody, let somebody call on Renner. You put a number on the screen. Let somebody call on the show Renner. That beside most of Rattle County. What is the national cemetery? Let me go a little bit farther. Since we talk about security, all the military people are serving our military. Where is this national cemetery for? Down to the president, even if something happened to them tomorrow.
Wow. Where do we bury them? That's a good
one. Look at Tubman right on Broad Street there. Barclay Inn, right in when you go to Firestone. Eh? CDB King right on the old road. Where? This is, we are the 21st century. It is time. It is time to start thinking. You go to Grand Jita. Do we got National Cemetery in Grand Jita? There's somebody coming, one of the county, the 15 county tonight. There's somebody coming beside Masura, the National Cemetery on Center Street that they closed. Beside, I seen it closed. The government have come with another National Cemetery in Liberia. The police, even down to the senator, then who writing the law? I live for a national cemetery. When they die tomorrow, where would they be buried?
Get into their country.
Give me up, Ray, will you? Really? Like my late brother can say, really? Really? The military. People. Just by we are not for a war. But it's about people, that the people who wore the uniform or who wear a uniform, when they die, there's no nonsense. We carry them behind our home, we bury them. It is time for change, people. It is time for us to start thinking. Maybe I'm passionate about it. Maybe I'm raising my voice. I'm sorry if I do. But these are things that we need to start thinking. Where is the local government? Where's the national government? The legislature, your thing, you're getting out of your buffer soon. You, when you die tomorrow as a senator, what they carry you? Carry we, they go bury where and we, yeah? Then where are you? But we need to have a national cemetery where our officials of government will be buried. I'm not even talking about our local government, but officials of government, so that tomorrow, Senator Z come from this place, she or he over there. When it comes to our Senate, I call it the cemetery, so you need to be localized. People die. One of my brothers said, we bury them on the beaches. So it is time for us to start thinking. We got too much land in our country for us to do this thing.
All right, let's go to thank you so much. Where is the local government? What a consequential good question. I want to see what I have an answer because I almost slapped one city mayor in my own village. But let's go to this caller here and see here. Caller Ty, good evening.
Yeah, thank you, brother. So this is Volta, and I'd like to say hi to the panelists.
Mm-hmm.
tomorrow is our Decoration Day. And, you know, I'm listening to my brother Sisi, Mr. Bacon, and Terry speak about the Decoration Day, especially the two big cemeteries that in Central Monrovia, Central Street and Gurney Street. You know, I think people are not educated to respecting sacred places in our country. And like Mr. Balcon said, we don't have any measurement. I mean, certain things that we consider pride. I would look at it to be pride. I remember even as far back as in the so-called Norman days in Liberia, people used the cemetery for latrine. We used to play soccer on the, in Gutter Street, on Gutter Street, in Gutter Street graveyard. We call it the graveyard, it's still the graveyard. We used to play soccer in Central Street graveyard. And people used to use that place as dumping site to dump garbage. People that lived along the fence of the cemetery, both Central Street and Gutter Street, used that place as dumping site, garbage dumping site. People also used it for latrine. Graves were being bust in Central Monrovia when people buried a loved one. If not careful, the next day you go back there, the grave is bust, the casket disappear, the body probably on the floor. We saw all those things happen normal day in our country. And then our Civil War came, where that cemetery was used as almost a battleground for all of the warring factions, even the Mediterranean. And I think if you have a Dumia, that was Dumia, were even captured from.
Yes.
That place there.
Yes, so, Street, yeah.
We that place has gone through a lot of, it's for me, it's pathetic how we don't have respect in all aspects. And people think that, I don't know what's going on in our country. I think we should enforce our law. We have all the laws in the books because we mimic the American Constitution. But what is lacking is enforcement. People sit in our Congress or Senate or whatever. They make laws that will protect them, protect the pocket, put more money in the pocket. Do not do what is right for the public. And that will hurt me. That will break my heart about our nation. It breaks my heart. You guys should edit on about the police. A senator will take $30,000 to say is constituency, how they call it, engagement. Do you know how many motorcycle $30,000 can give the police force to run after crimes? Some of that, I think Terry was talking about in the rural era. And people don't have cars or even go. Even in Morocco, when you got streets, how many police cars you see on the road going to address crimes? Before I say motorbike. I mean, let's say motorbike before I say car. Where they got streets? The city has gotten so congested to the extent where to travel from Broad Street, up Broad Street to go down Broad Street, it will take you almost 30, 40 minutes. You understand? They need to do something, set the priority right for our country. I think the citizens have to rise up against those people that just take Liberia for granted. They will come to this constituents or the constituency and make big promises. And when they sit in the house, it's all about them now. And then they act like they are bosses of the people. I think we have to start prevailing on those people. And what we should do, our next revolution. I think I'm tired of changing government or accusing president now, because that is the only part of the government that's supposed to hold the executive foot to fire or correct some of the things the executive are not doing. They are only there to enrich themselves at the detriment of our country. People don't care. Look at the Capitol building. The front of the Capitol building had a big pothole. You want to tell me, look, I was driving all the $45,000 car. They could not buy 2-3 cement there and follow across right there and face my record due or $25 work right there, face that place. The whole, I used to see that and I'm like, how are you guys doing it? They will get all of the capital building and go behind the capital building to pee. You put me in plastic bed and throw it back there. for heaven's sake. That recent time when like will pull up when Mary Brown, the tenant that I play with nasty after the up behind Mary Brown for cleaning the injury rock building and spoiling somebody banana man. They wanted to test up Mary Brown. Why Mary Brown had to do it? It was a down deal and Mary Brown so they wanted to call Mary Brown. Mary Brown said, that get it, sit and capital building and living. I ain't got no back when got so angry.
I'm a guy for me. Jesus.
When they got in the office before they got the bro boohoo. Boohoo now, the guy running water in the place for flush toilet and all that kind of stuff. Amen. For heaven's sake, man. Where are we? You're going to ride a $45,000 car on a public street in the country? When you die, like somebody said, why are you going to be buried? Now we got a private cemetery when you go to Broadway area there. That's where people going. You didn't pull a book in a photo box to put for it. About $5,000 for a lot. People can afford to be buried over there. What is going on? Let me. I'm graduating from a place where I'm going to start chastising the president. I think we should go into chastising president because when it will make the budget, it goes to the Senate. The Senate should be able to look in the budget and say no. We should have money for our security to make sure our first line of protection is our security. We should allocate money for our education because. Yeah. Of this country is the educated children of tomorrow. We should allocate money for agriculture because if we don't see ourselves, we don't see other nations. Unfortunately, those people don't see about it, Mr. So and the panelists. It breaks my heart. Thank you. I'm still on the line.
Sure. Okay. We already time caught up a lot. And just who was talking about. I think Sissy mentioned our back onto. I think a couple of years ago, I went after the old man, I went for the feast up interior. I think they need to, in a real problem, just difficult to talk. You're not just going to talk about one side, walking the top of the side, everywhere. This guy, he called himself the city mayor, not down to my village. I'm not going to apologize. Toll town, that a liberal progressive toll town. And we're in the conversation, the people not clean. I say, you said the city mayor. But the road, the path to a house, you got to find two stakes to do the bushes that day to enter. And he said, the people not brushing the town. How the hell are people going to brush the town when you can't even clean your own door more? And yeah, you say the city mayor. What makes you say the mayor?
You almost put sly in your ear.
Yeah. So I say you. They say you have to lead. To lead, to be a leader, is not just say, are they this. No, it comes with attributes. It comes with different quality for people to see in you. Yes, so that they will follow emulate your example. Okay, let's see here. Dr. Jones is on the line here, and we will soon be wrapping up here. Time mascara would tend to be on time because this is how travel style. When you're not on time, then people get stuck. Dr. Marley Jones.
How are you, sir?
Good evening.
Good evening to you and fellow panelists.
Okay. When I saw the anyway, let me be nice. Go ahead.
The man's a doctor now, so
because he has a guest in
he's being selective on the platform.
Yeah. So what I want to suggest is that I hear the panelists talking about national cemetery to bury when the senators die or politicians die or those who are in government die, you know. But I think those are private matters. Those are private matter. When you die, it is the prerogative of your wife and children and extended family to decide where you should be buried. So I don't know why we should shift that burden on national budget. Probably what we could do, we could focus on a cemetery where those who don't have their hand can go there and bury their people, but even at that,
what kind of hand they get again?
Well, come on, not all the hands are equal in our country.
Nobody said they're not getting hair. That means they can't even eat or they can't do anything. Which are the hair you talking about?
Well, I'm talking literally from another state, from another on the skin. Okay. That means they don't have money to bury their own people. Yes.
Metaphor is being applied. All right. Yes. Well, in your hand, I thought that they need help to carry
the issue of cemetery, in fact, the federal status of the cemetery right now is reflection of the type of leadership we've been having since 1847. You see? So at the end of the day, even for those who are in the United States, yeah, we have the veteran cemetery. Even those era, they are all held by private institutions. All right? So it should be the prerogative of municipal cities and towns to get involved into those things. But channeling the national budget into those era, when a president, a person dies, senator dies, we should go bury them. That's a private prerogative. So we have to leave it to them, their children, their family, and their extended family. Then back to the issue of the police. People are seeing that our police go around begging, and the panelists say they are being challenged. You see, what is unfolding in Liberia now, these are not strange phenomena. These things have been on for a very, very long time. But our problem, I think, is that we are expecting more from a government that will put itself on a high pedicule that, yes, we can do this, we can do this, we can do that. Joseph Boakye and his government will only do their best. And they will pass. Another group will come in. But the question now is, what they're focusing on, is that a priority right now? Do you really need what they're focusing on right now?
Which one?
I'm asking a question. The president and his government came, they made a lot of promises. Are those promises a priority right now?
What is the example?
Or they're going to try their best and maybe leave the scene and another government come in.
So we should.
As I simply always said, we've got good policy on the book. The enforcement and the implementation will never come to pass because Liberia was never built on the foundation of patriotism. It was built on the foundation of exploitation. The concept of transforming Liberia, the concept of looking at Liberia as a plantation coming to harvest, the concept is still proliferating up to today. We always count on this part, we always get on so many media just for intellectual purposes. Okay. But the foundation, you know, everything goes wrong with the child. I yield.
All right.
I wanted to ask the doctor some question, boy.
You don't count OPM, so can I? Conference room here. Okay, let's see here.
The doctor want us to be better or president or what?
Yeah, okay. Let's deal with the two callers and I'll come to you. He's still here. He can hang in there. Let's see this number 202, number 2214. Are you there, caller? What's your name and where you calling from?
Good evening. This is Bigger Call.
Oh boy. Here we go.
No, that was old boy today. And I think, okay. You know, they're talking about discussing. I went there 2 different times. They were nowhere to find. They went and buried on the grave. I know the man grave because they're the same thing. One year before you go. When I saw the general attack sharing here, because it touched me to the last. I went there several times. There were nowhere to find my man grave because it was the era that I knew about. When I went out, I saw several new graves. You know, 1 year before you were allowed to go there. So when I started showing you, I saw a gentleman, I said, when I have him, like, at least I call him, I say, me see where I go there, I post car on here, to business one, do you know? Or when I went there, you know the fun. So when you say, I start showing me there, I start sharing here. That's why I get it. I go down.
So yeah, breakable. I would know this is a very painful thing, and this is why was who ourselves, national government, those in authority to get certain things done. We should protect our own alligators, and this is this that's the problem with Liberia. What I'm saying is coming from the Helen government and all of that. And I'm moving forward. That's what we need to be doing because
that what we're discussing. So I don't want to make up for in politics. But this I think that it's existing ever since. You need a fast solution. I tell you. You see, the question I tell my being now, we need to discuss about solution and start shaving blame. Yeah. Because what happened now is they just stretch it. Every boy idea of changing out the area and correct someone else. But if the man of fact, the way you want to use it, all folks are going against it. Look, everything in Liberia is politics. No. Even they are talking about your we are, if you the women are political, or you know, look at policing.
You stay finding ways to
Breakable can be sleeping, dreaming ever.
I think we all put aside who we support, who we didn't support, and start getting into feelings, emotions, and all of that, and just look at a bigger picture and make some sort of comparison. Why this thing is going on, X, Y, Z, A, why it's not happening in our own? Is it because we're so much, I don't know, that in love or lost? For these people to call our leaders are not making good judgment. It's not just only the executive branch, the legislature, the first branch, the judiciary, and even we ourselves, the citizen, we do some crazy thing.
Well, Mr. So,
let me check. I know I got my take off. I know.
Yeah.
Let me just put my closing remark and I'll take off. See, the thing with our system, the things that we need in our home is the system. System, the Bill Clinton system, stupid. It's a system. Here you are, you're driving from 95 to Rhode Island, get on 95. They say no lorry. You will not see no trash. No trash. When you get to the gas station, you will enter your trash and put it there and leave. Today, what? Tuesday, tomorrow morning. Your trash, you will put it outside. They will come and pick it. It's the system. If the system, if we had, let me just put in an elementary or maybe in psychology perspective. The children are born here. Look at them. They have been indoctrinated. Look at your child when they started going to school. All of them will run to that water cooler. All of them will run. But as soon as one person, the first person get to that water cooler, the rest will follow. No more fighting. Everybody will just get online. You must say we can go to the basketball. Thousands of people can go into that basketball stadium. In 30 minutes when that game is over, you don't have nobody there. There's no noise.
is a system. When you go to the basketball, yeah, go to ATS. By the time you get up from there, your whole shirt, then it's a system. When they say 2,000 people supposed to be in the stadium, that 2,000 people get in that stadium. Even when you go here, you're renting a hall. They say 150 people. The fire marshal will kind of say, shut it down. So even for all what you must say we are saying here tonight and different perspective, if we had a system, once we put system in place, my brother, Liberia on the right path. Until the system is not in place, we are wasting our time, we are wasting our precious time. All we need to do is to develop a system. Let me conclude with this. Some of our children here, you live in a district, your child cannot go into the school in the other district. It's a system. They say, what about a private school? But a government school, you can leave Zoom 1 and go to Zoom 2. They say, you got a private school. So the only thing we need to do is a system. If we can put a system in place, brother, our radio listener, TV listener, those are watching us, that's our problem in our country. If we can get a system, that's it.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. I'll see you guys tomorrow at the same time. Oh, finally. I think the Babli people having that something. Anyway, we and Babli people will be there, be represented. Okay? Babli
people will see you. Okay. So much. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. Okay, guys. We'll try to be keeping time, let's go to Keto.
Yes,
okay, 1 minute. Yes. Make your what's the final closing statement?
Well, I think we who on these platforms and advocating for the betterment of our country, I think now we should start looking beyond associating with political parties, maybe sort of protecting our own alligator or protecting our own devil interests and put our country first. I see that. We continue to protect our political leaders, our political party when we have power. So when they do wrong, we don't see it. And I think if we start to see Liberia as that big pie that we all are nothing but that we all belong to instead of a particular institution, I think we'll be doing ourselves justice because just 6 years ago, President, we were in office and some of us maybe didn't see the wrong that was doing, that was happening in the country. I mean, the slow pace that country was moving in, people wouldn't see it.
It's 6 years ago, yeah.
We're getting older. I'm being very honest here. Like I said, moving forward, you hear my tone is going to be very different.
Oh.
I'm not going to be chastising. Yeah, I'm serious. I'll use the word nonsense for us to continue talking every year. Just go and just bash this government. We'll come out to the same place. We'll bash it on the government. We'll come out to the same place. We'll bash it on the government. We'll come out to the same place. What is that? If the government is in our favor, and I see my brother Kerry, some of the things that he bashed, government for, it's like he turned back. You would tell me that President Weah left the city dead for the new government to come and take place. For any one President Weah came
in, who said that?
He was a mess.
Who said that?
Kerry. He said all the things came from President Weah and President Brock are inherited. Okay, government is continuing to say any government that you left, the city dirty, President Weah inherited a dirty city that was not even, there was no system to dispose of garbage. Look, there were so many things, and we should not blame it. I'm not putting on government right now. I'm trying to say we can fix this as the people and young people that consider ourselves to be a little bit exposed and wise, that we see the wrong, we say we make it and watch it. Let us try to start talking to government, holding their feet to fire to do the right thing instead of us protecting them. Because it will affect you, it will affect me now, it affects the United States people. All the mess that President Weah left behind. So they are, when you see, so what the government is doing, they say, oh, that President Weah left it there. Okay. So the mess, if the brother leaves, the next government will come.
Thank you so much.
I left it there. I did it. So we have to get away from this and put this country first, so we can hold those people we consider demons. We can hold their feet to fire to do the right thing instead of using our people to enrich themselves.
Thank you so much. Dr. Jones?
Yes, sir.
Let's hear you. Your final message.
Well, sorry that our guest left earlier. He mentioned that we don't have system. And it's like I don't want to push back in his absence. We'll meet again, but
Papa been reading too much.
He's been like,
you want test mess or back on strength? He will come for you, dude.
Hello,
now go ahead, Dr. Jones.
Yes. So when I go back to the Moral City Corporation ordinance, there are so many in there, things in there where when they catch you throwing trash, they can find you, they can do process you through the court, look at system. I think what we're lacking here is our ability to hold people accountable with patriotism. I think that what is conspicuously missing, you see. But for instance, if I grab Sese Song for throwing trash on the street, Sese will take a phone. Sese myself, if we went to school together, you call me, oh, Jones, oh man, I beg you, I'm here at my song. I know you will not do that thing again. You know, we are human beings, especially we are African. That tendency for us to compromise, that one destroying Liberia today, you see? So I don't know at what point we'll get to that level. To hold people accountable. That's the only way Liberia will move forward. But I see it in a long distance, probably not even my lifetime, you will experience that thing, because Liberia has been classified as one of the third world countries. So I don't know. And what I'm seeing now is in all sectors in Liberia, all sectors. If I think are even worse now, you see.
Oh, you know, you're throwing stone now. Yeah, already.
CEO, when I use the word thing are worse now, it's like it been worse ever since. It continues to get worse. And His Excellency, trust me, he will get trying the own of best, and the local government will come in. Let's say, always say, we got good policy on the book, to be frank with you. But the implementation and holding people accountable, that is the gap.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay, let's see here. We say we don't want to leave no one behind. We intend that to, but let's hear you quickly here. 1 minute. I would just want to value to your opinion of you. 609 number 0405. You there?
Yes.
Good evening. What's your name and where you calling from?
Good evening, Mr. Stowe, and good evening to your panelists. Thank you for having me. I just want to talk on the topic. We're just talking about the system. Like a comment on the show that the system is I don't know. If the system is in place, or is the system probably be the problem, or so overlooking the system with the with we're talking about Decoration Day and the cleaning of graves or so. I think if this is done quarterly, I think we're going to have something good that will have to do with debt and stuff will not be piling up in the graveyard. Decoration Day is done once in the year. Mm-hmm. So why is it true that we celebrate Decoration Day once a year? But I think cleaning up of graves should be done quarterly in the week. Then we will have to alleviate the pile of dirt and other stuff along the cemetery.
I just told them that I think.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you for you. We really appreciate it. Okay, guys, we are really over time, almost 25 minutes instead of 2 hours. And sometimes it's difficult when it's up for your country, then. Well, this is, we got to be managing time too as well. This is where the field system comes in, right?
Right.
Yeah, because nobody pay anybody overtime. Okay, Eric, let's hear you.
Yeah, thank you for the show, Mr. So, but I think it was good that these discussions be held so that those who are listening can be abreast with what's going on. But yeah, I want to support Mr. Bacon on the issue of having a national cemetery, all right? I was just looking up what he said, and I think that is what is done in America too. You know, and Mr. Mali tried to weigh in on that, but you know, it's good for your military to have a cemetery, your presidents to have a cemetery. There was a law that was enacted on behalf of the military in America, you know, which covers the president and all of that, to have a specific place of burial. But unfortunately, only two presidents of America have been buried there. But the military have a place to be buried unless their families want to take them elsewhere, that become a personal issue. But it is very good that our country have a national cemetery for the military and people, presidents and people who are in security apparatus that are of high dignitaries, so that there can be some level of honor and dignity to the office in which the person occupies, which may also encourage other people to want to become part of that particular, you know, group, the military and all of that, you know. So I don't think it's good thing to have people just being buried randomly all over the place. No. And I also want to agree that the local government should take charge in regulating, you know, cemeteries in Monserrato County and outside of Monserrato County. And the government also need to be in force to make sure that people don't just be buried anywhere. Right now in Liberia, people are being buried anywhere. Every time you look, there's a new cemetery opening somewhere. We also need to take into consideration, I don't know if this may throw off the discussion, but in America, they also do a cremation, all right, to reduce, because if you have a lot of cemetery in places like Monserrato County, which made the capital city, and people are dying every day, people burning, people dying, sooner or later, you will not be able to, you will have a congestion in the city, wherein there will be cemetery all over the place. So we have to either find a way to designate a cemetery outside of Monrovia, a big land that will be able to cover a huge amount of people, or we find a way to do cremation. All right, which of course, as a Christian man,
decision of the people, well, the decision of the family, right, or individual, the deceased.
That could be a decision of the people, but people have to introduce it before it become a priority. But for me, as a Christian, I don't support cremation. But as a nation, as a country, there are some things you got to look at when it comes to population growth, congestion, and all of that. And also, you know, I think that the fire in Liberia, that even though we don't talk about it, but one of the strategies that I see in America that I think would be good for Liberia is the fire detector. They got a fire detector in the house. They put a used battery, so you don't have to have current to have it. I think the government need to put some things in perspective that will make at least every home to have a fire alarm, a fire detector. That fire detector in the house, once there's a smoke, the fire detector will alarm. So even if you're sleeping and fire break out in the house, it will help to save your life, because the detector will alarm you that there is a fire in the house. That thing have a sharp noise and it's gonna make noise. So we have to begin to address this issue. The government have to address it. And to Keto, you were talking about, what I was trying to say is that President Boyka took over since almost 3 months now, all right? And he had been addressing when he came into power, he made the country filthy. And you know that. I'm surprised that you know that very well. Even your boy, your man, Akaris Green, all right? His district was the most filthiest district in Monrovia,
in Monrovia. They met the Papa had to organize people to clean the place for the inauguration. He had to clean the city. You know, so when you telling me say that, oh, you know, but what Jefferson Koji was doing in the city, what was he doing? Can you really tell me what he was doing? The other day, Mr. So even put the I think Rayleigh, one of your guys went to Rayleigh or so. We discussed it on the show where he highlighted a whole part of that. So Keto, please don't be doing that. Thank you very much, Mr. So.
You think that between you and Keto, I think maybe two or 2019. Who will see who will do? Okay, so let's say Mr. Guaya, let's hear you.
I like the fact that Keto now leave me small and here and Terry inside. So
I tell you that I thought I said you were coming go to.
No, let me put my hand. Remember, definitely in our cash app, Benny will go
now. Oh, I see.
I reckon many of the men to more Ali. And Mr. Malepano, he come out with the plow, Benny, if you did. But on a serious note, Mr. Jones,
guys, I gotta hang up now for the phone because you know that the audio coming down or something. Okay, Keto and Dr. Jones, we've got to see you. I think you're getting the feedback. I don't know where it's coming from.
They just got a mute. I don't know.
Yeah, go ahead, sister.
Yeah, Dr. Jones made some salient points. We don't lack of system. I keep telling people, Liberia has enough systems.
I agree.
It's the enforcement. It's the enforcement. There are city ordinances. I remember when I used to go to Lofa for vacation. The commissioner of Zozo District will go from village, from town to town. They will say the inspector coming to inspect the sanitary conditions of the town. And people were fine. You know, so all of those cities, all of those, they still have ordinances on the book. They just have to enforce them or maybe revise them, right? But I really, something say really struck me. And I wanted to speak to them. When you talk about the this is not just the failure of the executive branch, Mr. So, you talk about the legislative branch. And this is where we all, I mean, when I say we all, us on this platform, have to take some share of that lashing. That we sometimes allow ourselves to get carried away by the mundane stuff. The political clown, the circuits, we follow it. And we don't, you know, we do well on this platform, but we don't go. Sometimes we are still struggling with how do we say, I don't want anyone chunking that way. I want it. You know, that you're eating grumpy. You get out one rat, you want to pull it in mud. You can mess up your whole day. I had that problem. You know, so we sometimes we get a good thing. We find one rat is thing up in. Time for the language. We all jump behind it. And I think that's where we drop the ball. But look, I'm thinking about if somebody is running for election to be a representative, or if they are a representative, and they're making district reports, which all of these representatives do, or they're coming back for re-election. The critical questions our people have never asked or seldom asked, how many schools are in your electoral district, Mr. or Mrs. Representative? How many high schools have you managed to bring to our electoral district?
Mm.
What is the graduation rate of the public school students in your electoral district, or Madam Senator, Mr. Senator, in your county? What have you done to increase the graduation rate? What are the classroom sizes in Bonk County? What have you done at the national level, the legislature, to reduce the classroom sizes? How many clinics do we have in Lofa County? You don't have more than 3 public high schools in that large county. We don't ask those people those questions. We say, instead, they will make one flyer with something like Tabe Boshi and say, integrity, accountability, like Pape Tanopoli to say, I'll be your people, I'll do your people. They tell us things that is not in their wheelhouses, and so we don't hold them accountable. right? How many times have we asked legislators or people running to be legislators, how many jobs did they advocate for to come to the county? And when I say jobs, I'm not talking about government jobs. I'm talking about private entities coming to the county. Since you became a legislator, how many people have you taken off unemployment and in power? What is the death rate? What is the infant mortality rate? How many women are dying at childbirth? When you came, how many were dying? How have you reduced that? How have you made sure that the hospitals are staffed? How many clinics, now that you build from your pocket, have you advocated with national government to build and fund and staff?
A lot of people money when they were not sending to
already. So the reason I'm saying that is they take this money and they build some kind of house and call it clinic, and they don't give national government got no control over it. By the time they get defeated, our building stay there, so grass get inside. So we don't want you building school out of your pocket. How are you putting that in national budget? We're dealing with that thing today with the WIAC fees, right? Because it did not get codified in law. Now we have the issue of that. So this is my, and that's why I'm sitting here, and like I said, my new role is going to be different. With the next elections that I get here in Liberia for representative or to fill Jeremiah Kuhn positions, all other people. We're going to be making sure that our people are asking those critical questions. Don't tell us, say, you will come, you will put this body on scholarship, we don't care. We should not be caring about that anymore. How are you a senator for 18 years and you have not brought one high school to your county? How are you a senator for 18 years in your sub-region? All of you in that one sub-region, there is not one university, public university, issuing a bachelor's degree. Go to Lofa County, Mr. So. Lofa County that used to boast of having the smartest people and one of the most educated per capita. You cannot get a bachelor's degree if you live in Lofa County. You can't. You got to leave Lofa County with a bachelor's degree. Because we only got a community college there. Yet we got people who sit at the state, in the state capital. Right? A current hospital in Zozo closes so many times, and there's no medication. Yet these people, our people will be dying and be voting for these people. This issue about the death and the remembrance of the dead, I think ought to spark a debate around how do we educate our people so our people know how to hold their people accountable. When my brother Abraham Darius DeLong sit and say we're holding people accountable, we're starting the light, let's say, yes, we agree. But Mr. Light, can you tell us what have been some of the things you brought for to reduce the infant mortality rate in Mosawara County? We can ask that question in a respectful way and ask for answers from our own brothers and our own sisters that we brought to power. And last but not least, I want to say, my brother, Keto, welcome on board. This is what we've been saying for a long time. We got a local Liberia from an apolitical lens. I don't know who put pepper soup that you drank, that you stopped seeing, you know, that I thank God you drank that pepper soup, even though it's been late, but thank God you drank the pepper soup. Come on, Bo. Let's talk about that.
Baya Kuma.
It's better late than never. And I think another great piece that left out just to add to your argument is 6 years ago, they were representative, they were senator. What was the population of that district of their town now to their present time? Because it is based on that. You will say, hey, go to international organization. These conferences that you go to, where when they can't, nobody know what's happening. Look, when I was elected 2023, this district, this county, the population were X, Y, Z. But see how far it has gone. This is the reason, instead of health center or instead of clinic or so, maybe we need a hospital because there's a growth in population. And this is how these international organizations, and I just want to say it, like you said, and like we've all been saying here, it has to be factual. And that comes with data. 2022, we were what? 10,000. 2023, now we are what? 6,000, 7,000. This is what we have. This is the number of people from the women, the children, the age, this age group, that group. Based on this, this is what is needed for our county, for our district. When you present that, then it becomes concrete.
It's not it's no longer an abstract thing, because you give it in real time and they have it. And they're gonna act on it.
And not to cut you off, that people will sit in Monrovia and say, oh, Monrovia too crowded. How do we get the people to leave the city? Why am I gonna leave the only place that I can get bachelor's degree? I want children, one get higher education. Why would I leave the one place that got hospital? You think I want for my children and myself to go in the bush to go die? Why would I leave the one place where all the job wasting? And you're telling me why we can't go back to the village? Why you can't go back to the village, dude? You get people in your village.
But Mr. So I thought that this the sensor. These things supposed to already be there.
Everybody not bring different thing on you. It's just sensor.
The sensor. It's supposed to give us data as regarding our population in various districts and towns and townships and all that.
In our respect to as well, if you are a representative, if you're going out there to lobby it, they don't want to give you the whole. You're going to narrow your scope of conversation with where you want resources to be directed. Right. So let's assume if the sensor, if it is done accurately the time it should be, you can extract that part. You can get to the authority and say, hey, I'm going after, because you need to take something for which you're going to negotiate so there can be a backing in place, because you're not just going to log in and say, oh, how many people you have? I think that time. No, they don't get time for that nonsense, that bullshit. You're wasting people's time.
Mr. So, this is just laziness, right? Not to cut you off. Yeah, look.
That's what I think. The sensor
is past due, and we know we need a sensor. But the UN has a population projection that we usually take our sensor to compare with to get an act. So even in the absence of a national sensor, the data is out there from the United Nations. All you have to do is get people, researcher in your office, Mr. Senator, Madam Senator, Mr. Representative, Madam Senator, Madam Representative, let those people pull those data. And this is where you're supposed to have those conversations during budgeting at the national legislature. Instead of all of that clown show they can put up there, this is when you stand up and say, I from Salaye District, Lofa County, there is no public high school in my district. My population is increasing. I need you to have money in this budget to have a public high school in my district. And
totally agree.
I need a clinic in my district. Here is the infant mortality rate. This is what the death rate is from the Ministry of Health. We need this. When you argue those in the House, now even the people in the higher echelon of the House and the Senate, they can now even talk to other people in the country and say, look, here are the things our legislators are saying. These are the things we see on the ground. How can you help? NGOs, when you're coming in, these are the places we need help. Because this is what our people who represent the people, the representatives, are telling us this is what they need. That is how you do smart governance. But when it's budget time, they don't even argue for their people. Mr. So, you come from the South. Tell me how many high schools you're getting in Grand Junior County. Public high school, I'll say private. Public
don't
high school.
For my evening here, I beg you.
Yeah, this is the point. And we get people that will sit there all day and would never advocate for the bread. When you go to the legislature, you're supposed to take pork back to your people. You're supposed to take bread back to them. When you're coming back, you say, I bring in two clinics. I bring three high school. I bring in five police officers. This is what I'm bringing. This is the bread you sent me to go bring. I'm bringing it back. But they can't. The people just go dance around their house and they get in one bag of radical. They go back.
Interestingly enough, all the old man,
Oh, Lord, man. So the people got to do that thing to get a small team back.
It's hard to talk. Wow. I know I got an info today, Joseph Boyka, that old man, people talking for granted of his age, different something, but when they say hi, like old man, he's the one. Because people thought that he could be used so easily. I'm telling you. There's a senator who crying now, not only praying Johnson alone, who wants to talk to Mr. Boyka, and Boyka now is refusing. And they have a serious debt. These people are digging and digging and digging.
they asset recovery here. They're gonna be like a GV20 in Sano 1970.
I hold on, Amara Cornell.
Okay, we're meeting Amara Cornell for he say in a safe haven.
No, you said as a senator.
Senator, yeah, they are all involved. When he was Minister of Foreign Affairs, you know, in government, people, they don't know, for you know, the work in government. But government is where some sort of bargaining chip goes in. It's difficult, even here in the West, to say you just want to fight again. There's a given thing. Why you think sometimes the Republican, the Democrat, when they push for the shove, the president will tell whoever's in control, just go and do a bargaining chip. We can give this, we give this. When you say you want to help the president, interest the president proportionally can hook you.
Mm.
So they recovered in here. They boom the door and swallow 5-10 years ago. Some of them they will end up vomiting it.
I told the president I want to be on our team. I only want to be there for one reason, to get our work out to your back. Oh, the my only place.
Why are you behind Zamba?
But Sissy, you will be the right man because me, I know you. When you say that one plus one is two.
what's about a liberal?
The liberal can compromise. Liberal is sympathetic. All I think liberal can talk, when liberal get a problem with you, you will talk it straight. If anyway. But we need people like Sissy that when he stand on something, he stand on it. He will find the end game before he finish with it. You know, like you saw the few day what he did when he jumped behind you, he jumped behind you. You will see the end before he finished.
You know what happened after
that? The kind of people that contacted me
after the program that last week, I was forced to switch my phone off.
Oh,
just to get a break. Yeah, I mean, it was a true question. It was, you know, this wrestling total submission on the poor people in the cage, and you got to tap before people sign the bell. That was the case. But guys,
that's what make LPR different. We hold the issues and we move. And that's why I say this network has a great potential if people would just invest in it. If our viewers would just subscribe for that 99 cents, if our viewers will continue to share the show, we have this platform has a huge potential because this is where we come. We do educational programs. It's not always for politics. Our man does the Sunday thing, dancing for Jesus. So we don't always come here and tear down the country. We provide prescriptions also. We're not like other places that you just go and it's always just doomsday. So again, this is my plug to say, you know, if you're watching us, if you're on the phone and you look at the bottom of your phone, there is a black heart like button. You click on it, you subscribe for 99 cents. It's not, it is a lot to us. That's your money. We appreciate that. But subscribe. And if you care now, we understand things are hard on some people, just share the show. That's all you can do. Invite somebody else to come. And you can always call in the chat with us. Don't be that breakable. Who always got a mid plow with me?
The man came here to Nestle. You were not feeling good. So, yeah, what happened? I reached out to some high profile individual for us to have. Then it's still. The only way I will come when I email on your program when the email when I come all there, I said, who the email? Is it a man from Minnesota? I'm like, oh Lord. I said, why? Is it and the war somewhere there? I said, Zalo, I'm not coming there. If you guarantee me that the email will not show all there, I will come. So I said, all right, but we'll fool you. So you can't after 10 minutes you get jump in.
we can always watch. You know, look, let me tell you something, Mr. So. I've grown on this platform. I've always had my own fight, but I've grown on this platform watching, trying to find my little spot between you and the liberal. And then, you know, then it was Jonathan was here and back then, you know.
Jonathan, why is he? Is
he? Right? See, you probably in trouble. And, you know, and then we had it. And then we had the two ladies. Remember, we had a lawyer at one point. Hey, I need to reach out to my sister, auntie. I thought about, you know, on time. You know, and all of those jockeying. So we managed, we all now found our niche. Terry came along, you know, he too has, you know, when we bump and bump and bump, it kind of now got his own little niche, like our own little spot. And LP Hour is unique in that way. You know, there are sometimes other people come on and say, I will stay off the show today because, you know, when I come in, my perspective might not be necessary to carry the show on. Sometimes I sit in the back and just watch it. That's what make LPR, and we're no other place. You know, that's what we're not. We're not a cooking show. You know, we're not Spoon, we're not Copa, we're not anything else. You know, we're just LPR.
Okay,
you see, I got two jobs.
So the liberal, so tomorrow is Wednesday, right?
Yeah.
Liberal is asking me to sit in for me, but he's trying to be like Netanyahu now and Joe Biden.
Oh,
I told him I'm gonna think over it. He having a guest here tomorrow, and he wants to do it exclusively. So I said, but traditionally, this network will have a guest. The 2 hours that is elected, you have your hour exclusive, and then the analysts come in. But the liberal, what I anticipate and forecast this liberal wants to do is he wants to wave a white flag to this guest. And I know exactly what is in
the coming on. They coming for him buying Liberty Party.
No, some of his defunct Liberty Party people that Charles Bronskin left by the wayside. They kind of try to regroup.
And I already knew where you were going. I called your name. I already knew where you were going.
So that's what the liberal is proposing. The liberal is telling us, not just only me, it is level you guys to have your support. I know the play he had, now he's balling with him. He want to do it on his own. He alone. Can you imagine?
I never enjoy it. Yeah, but
the more a busy day, but I would say him get on my account when they're getting out of Keto, Breakable, 30-30, all my count, they're getting hot down tomorrow.
All right, so we're going to say about that.
You're good, okay,
guys. Thank you so much.
Yeah, good night, man.
Thank you so much. Okay, well, folks, that does it this evening. I'm Afonso Z. and Sort of the Liberal Public Radio and LPR TV. Look, we'll try to reach out to the city corporation. Somebody should be held accountable. We saw the images, the day should be respected. And not just only the cemetery in Center Street, but all around, to the extent that even you can't even locate family person resting place. You take all of these monies, $1,000, $1,003 for whatever space you pay for it, and at the end of the day, they never go back there. The people there, they take it, they drink in June, and that's it. So if Liberia is to be bleached, if Liberia is to be good, I think all sectors of the government, society, community should be visited. There are people responsible, from the city corporation to the communities. You don't just get and go buried. They get the people there, although plenty chairman for day. You pay money to these people, and that's it. They get the money, and they're gone. We want to thank you so much. Again, if you have your events and you need some sort of advertisement, commercial type of business inside Liberia, right here in the USA. That's all we ask for. We don't want just beg you without rendering services to you. We are a community-based network. We must provide services, and then you pay us or you give us something. I think that is a fair deed. That is much better. It's much better than always to ask you. But we are in the process. We don't usually put our cash out or Zelle, none that we do not have, but we vowed not to until we ourselves make a progress, something concrete, something tangible that you will see and you will vividly to see it for which you can invest into. And hopefully that will happen sooner than later. But in the meantime, it is what it is. Like Sister says, subscribe. Follow us, look for the notification by icon, and make sure you highlight all notification. And that way you will get all live view. Well, before I sign up, today is someone special birthday. That's my sister. And yeah, not just a sister, she's a mother. I'm blessed. They are also running Maine, go towards Massachusetts, come down to Providence. I'm in the middle, reachable to all of them. I can grab my leg quick. Stuff and go. I don't care what Nathaniel or Samson to tells me and whatever. I don't care. Well, today is a birthday, and we had a time to spend some little quality time with all that says Rita there and says T. Yeah, today is a birthday, and I want to thank God for her for being part of being in my life, for being the sister, for being a mother. So, sis, enjoy your birthday. My consignment that I brought, I still have all of them, and I'm going to help myself barely before I go to bed and even tomorrow. Until then, let's do this for you before we go. All right. This is how we want to leave it at this event. I'm Afonso Zian. So we will be initiating something here, LPR Prime members, and you're going to be coming with some lot of benefits as well. Who knows, you get someone in Liberia, you have an event coming up, and you need some live coverage event. That Prime membership, it comes with that benefit. It is your birthday, it's your anniversary, whatever memorable day that you have, it could apply to that. But we are working on that plans, just to let you know, LPR Prime member, Prime followers, it comes with a little package. That's another way of contributing so that we can make this network more viable. Until then, folks, have a pleasant evening, and by God's willing, same time, same station. Join the Liberal Progressive, the only liberal on this network from Totem. He will be on tomorrow. He will be sitting in the... Because he asked me to sit in for him yesterday, today. The old man swore say tomorrow, he must sit. So I've agreed. Temporarily, but who knows what happens tomorrow. My mind could change. But in the meantime, I've agreed. We're still negotiating if I will turn tomorrow over to him. But join the Liberal tomorrow, he's going to be having a fascinating program to hope to see. He will be hosting, my understanding, Bill Nyano. There are some group of Grangidians who have been discussing, who are opposing the superintendent designated by President Joseph Nyoma Mbweka. And some of us have different versions. So it'll be interesting. I'll watch and see how the conversation is going to go like. Because our understanding, they have raised money and all. Whether to lobby it, what that money was for, to get some of the information, over $2,000. And the people protest. So I'm wondering what other monies that were sent were used to buy stone for Grangidians, to stone their own fellow Grangidians. Is that the way to do it? Why couldn't they go and engage government or even call this young man who was designated by the superintendent if they have any apprehension? I'm hoping and I gathering all of the information needed. And I'll be monitoring closely the tone, the language, world by world, how the Liberal intend to host this conversation. Willie Nyano, he's a former president of Grangidian Association, formerly contested for a leadership. Is that a senator or representative? Also contesting. Why should he chair this and gather Grangidians? Was that the only way to do it? Or have they reached out to the candidate, the individual to designate? What other possible way they could have done it? And we understand some of the people who are arguing, they also have their own political interests. So then the issue of neutrality is complete 0 point. But we'll wait and see. We are closely monitoring. If people raise money to pay people to protest, his stone ordered Kingsman. People were arrested or carrying knives. Then that is a serious concern. You can lobby, you can make a presence feel if it is that so much important and serious. That money somebody could fly in and go and lobby with the committee and make their case and whatever they have, take it, say this is the reason why.
But we know some very people who polluted, who destroyed the Grand United Association, and they are here. And they want to be in a glass house to throw stone. Joseph Boyka is not going to withdraw that nomination. He learned a lesson from that of the chief of the minister to the Senate. But even if you want that to be done, I think you could do it better. But this divisiveness and people just render judgment based on pieces of information they hear without validating this information, I think it is wrong. Call the individuals involved and see, hey, I want to tell you, you want to be superintendent. What is your, what do you have in store for the county? We heard X, Y, Z. We want to hear your side of the story. That has not happened as far as I'm concerned. Prominent sons, daughters, they are involved. They are doing that. Be careful. Because while it is true, it is a legitimate case. But the trend, the route, who could possibly be held responsible to doing that demonstration when someone was killed? What would be the explanation? So people to keep our county hostage, your desire to throw yourself behind one party. That's what happens when people do not open their political mind. We saw that in the past. If you're not NDPO, then you're not a Grand Gideon. If you're not a sedition, you're not a Grand Gideon. You restrict your movement. You didn't create that openness politically. And politics is all about it. People who took the risk, whether you like it or not, they will put them there. It happens right here on our feet in this country. But for people to start, people to collect money without even then going and giving other people the chance to get their side of the story, to gather all of the facts and doing what they are doing, well, there will come a time we're going to empty all of the data out there. When we are getting some information. We are hearing now the executive mansion has cut off tie and he is not backing because they have a date on him when he was a minister of foreign affairs, Republic of Liberia. And we have those. So be careful. Be careful. Politics is not for children. If you're wearing diapers, don't get involved in politics. I'm Afonso Zienso of the Liberia Public Radio. We'll be back here. We'll turn into the Liberal Progressive and see how it goes tomorrow. Until then, have a pleasant, pleasant evening. Bye-bye.
Hello, welcome to Nkumusa Grocery, 6523 Woolen Avenue in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
I'm a customer of Nkumusa. I came here to get some things from grocery. Their things are so nice. They never get expired. They are the best quality. They have the best price ever anyone can get. They have so many things like cream, like meat, a lot of kind of meat. We have so many kinds, and it's the best grocery store I've ever seen here in Wood. We are located at the 65th and Woodland. If you want, I really appreciate you guys to come over to come and patronize with us because they sell